you're with your baby. Friday the 13th, Carnival of Maniacs, an original novel by Stephen Hand. Prologue. Come on, give me another chance. Stay a week. Help me get the place ready. By Friday, if you're not happy, I'll put you on the bus myself. Those four simple sentences kept spinning through Alice's mind as her face was slammed into the dirt for the second time. It seemed impossible that her thoughts could take a time out like this. Perhaps it was the shock of the impact of her nose almost breaking against the damp, compacted sand. She hoped to God that wasn't it. The last thing she needed now was concussion, now that she was fighting for her life. Grunting at the weight of the assailant pressing down on her back, Alice lay flat out on the ground. She was so close to the lake she could almost touch the water. Above her, the full moon cast a razor-sharp light that left no place to hide. It bathed her in a cold, gleaming light that was perfect for murder, yet she couldn't help noticing its beauty. She'd never seen a moon so big. It almost filled the entire night sky. So bright, so clear, so hypnotic. So easy just to surrender to it and let it all... No! Alice was shocked to realize the cry had been her own. She struggled and kicked beneath her attacker, but her efforts were for nothing. She was lying face down on the shore of Crystal Lake, pinned down by a full adult body's weight on Alice's slender teenage form. A powerful arm snaked around her throat, tugging into her neck with all the wrenching power of a hangman's noose. Alice retched at the kick she felt in her windpipe. She tried to wriggle out, to roll, to turn, anything, but the forearm was locked too tightly around her neck. She could see the strangling limb clad in thick, pale blue wool, a hard-wearing sweater worn by the maniac who was trying to kill her. Alice sank her teeth into the coarse knit and bit hard. It was her last chance, her last effort. Her attacker cried out in pain, and suddenly Alice could breathe again. But she knew she couldn't keep it up for long. Her pursuer seemed to have limitless energy, an unending capacity for violence. But Alice wasn't a fighter. She was just a mixed-up girl from California who liked working with kids. That's why she'd come to Camp Crystal Lake, to help teach valuable life skills to little boys and girls. Life skills such as how to defend yourself against a raging fucking psychopath. Alice heaved with all her might. Somehow she managed to push the powerful but wounded foe off of her back. Then she scuffed out from underneath. Suddenly she was free again. But for how long? Her desperate act had used up almost every last ounce of strength in her body. The slim blonde was practically exhausted, but her attacker? Alice knew her hunter would never give up. Once the pain of the bite subsided, the murderous onslaught would continue. Alice made for easy prey because she abhorred violence. She didn't have any real fight inside her, and each time she'd felt the physical impact of striking her attacker, even in self-defense, she'd wanted to throw up. All this punching and kicking and her crawling along the sand was coming from the pure animal instinct inside of her to survive. It was a pity that damn instinct hadn't kicked in when the camp owner Steve Christie had asked Alice to stay. What was it he'd said? Come on, give me another chance, stay a week. Those words again, so calmly persuasive. He'd spoken them only that morning while he and Alice had been fixing up one of the cabins. Now she cursed whatever it was that had made her agree. If she'd gone back to California as she'd planned, she wouldn't be running and screaming through a forest of dismembered human remains. She'd have been spared the gut-shuddering terror of seeing all her campmates slaughtered one by one in the space of a mere few hours. It had taken just one day for the silent killer to creep into the summer camp and butcher all six camp counselors. Annie, Ned, and Jack had all had their throats slashed. Marcy had taken an axe to the face. Brenda's dead body had been trussed up and thrown through a window. And Bill... Oh, God, Bill! He had been pinned to a cabin door with arrows, and not one of them was much older than Alice. As for Christy, he'd worked hard to restore the summer camp founded by his parents in 1935. The camp, all the locals said, was cursed. That had been shut down in 1962, following 5 years' bad luck. And the killer had rammed a knife into his gut. Great going, Mr. Christie. The camp hadn't even opened for business, and already everyone running the place was dead. Everyone, that is, except for Alice. Through a process of elimination, Alice Hardy, the girl who didn't even want to be at Camp Crystal Lake, had found herself alone against the maniac. The full horror of that night had crept up on her slowly. People had started to disappear. The power kept cutting out. The phone lines went dead. Then Alice thought she heard somebody scream. Everything was confused. But it was only when she discovered the stabbed, abused, mutilated corpses of the others that Alice realized there was a killer in the woods, and that she would be the final victim. 20 miles from the nearest town, she was being stalked by a predator with only one thought in mind. Kill, kill, kill. And so here they were, grappling by the boat dock, fighting on a shore that was no more like a sliver of sand beside a vast lake, a carcass of water enclosed by an impenetrable body bag of trees. Alice lurched to her feet and readied herself for the next deadly attack. She still could not believe that the killer was a woman. Dressed in a powder blue sweater, work boots, and dark jeans, Mrs. Pamela Voorhees cut the figure of a woodsman, a hunter. She wasn't particularly tall, nor in any way brawny, but her average frame exuded extraordinary physical power. Her whole body seemed coiled tight to kill, and it was clear she'd let nothing and no one stand in the way. Moonlight sparkled over her crop of permed blonde hair, and made her demented rictus grin appear even more deathly and deranged. But although the wild, dark eyes of Mrs. Voorhees were turned in Alice's direction, they were staring through the girl, seeing beyond to the waters of Crystal Lake, back to a time when her only child had drowned in its depths. Over 2 decades had passed since that terrible day in 57, when all the other little brats staying at the camp had tormented her poor, poor boy. They had teased him. They had made fun of him because his appearance was special. They had chased Pamela's son, and he had run away. He was crying as he fled along the boat dock where he'd stumbled and fallen. If the camp counselors had been doing their job, the boy would have been saved. But no, they were too busy playing and fucking around, and they left her poor boy to drown. And for that, they too had to die. Every counselor, every wretched teenager and meddling do-gooder who came to Crystal Lake, they all had to die. Pamela had succeeded in keeping the camp closed for over 20 years. A little fire here, a poisoned well there, nothing anyone could pin on her. But that fool Christie, Steve fucking Christie, whose parents went bust wasting money on this place, had thought he could start it all over again. He thought he could just forget about the past, reopen Camp Crystal Lake, and put more children at risk. More little ones who might fall into the water and drown just as Jason had. So Pamela was really saving people's lives. She had to deal with these teenagers in order to save the lives of infants, innocent children with warming smiles. Children who were still alive. Still alive, like the voice she could hear calling to her from the bottom of the lake. The voice of her son, Jason, speaking to her, talking into her mind. Kill her, Mommy! Kill her! Don't let her get away, Mommy! Don't let her live! Pamela almost choked with rage as she answered the sickly tones of her split personality, with a voice completely her own. I won't, Jason. Mommy won't. She reached a hand down to the leather sheath hanging off her belt, before remembering she'd left her knife buried in the gristle of Steve Christie's sternum. That's right. And then she'd hung the body out to dry. No, that was the first knife. It was her second knife she wanted, the knife that bitch Alice had knocked out of her hand with the poker. Oh, that girl. Christie, those filthy fucking teenagers. Didn't they understand this place was Pamela's hunting ground? Kill her, Mommy! Kill her, Mommy! Kill her! Alice could see Mrs. Voorhees steeling herself for one final attack. When Alice had first met Pamela less than a quarter of an hour ago, she thought the woman had come to save her. Pamela was around 50, for God's sake. Psychos were meant to be young men, sinister assassins, veiled in dark hoods, not middle-aged widows wearing sensible shoes. It didn't seem possible that Mrs. Voorhees could be the killer. Even when she told Alice some crazy story about her dead son and had come lunging at the girl with a hunting knife, Alice still couldn't believe it was happening. But then they'd fought, a brutal, desperate struggle for life. Alice had hit Mrs. Voorhees time and again, but the indomitable old bitch had just kept coming, thrusting, stabbing, punching, slapping, throwing the girl to the ground. Alice had run for her life, but couldn't get away. The automobile was out of action. The camp was littered with bodies, and worst of all, there was no place to hide. Pamela knew the layout of the camp better than Alice. And then there was the full moon, opposing all concealment and urging Mrs. Voorhees to ever darker deeds of lunacy. If Alice still needed persuading that Pamela had killed all her friends, then the woman's dummy-free ventriloquist routine was it. She heard Mrs. Voorhees speak to herself in that freaked-out baby voice. "Kill her, Mommy! Kill her!" Then followed a visceral game of cat and mouse, 10 nightmarish minutes that led to this final confrontation at the boat dock on the shores of Crystal Lake. Pamela had aimed a deadly machete blow at Alice, only for the girl to deflect it at the last instant with a canoe paddle. After a few more wild swings, the oar had been broken in half. The machete bashed out of Pamela's hand, and the maniac had dived on the girl from behind. They'd wrestled and grappled on the sand, Pamela grabbing hold of Alice's hair and repeatedly shoving the girl's face into the dirt. Once, twice, which was when Alice found herself despondently recalling Steve Christie's words asking her to stay. But here now, standing but a few yards away from her deadly opponent, Alice could see Pamela was no longer bothered by the teeth marks in her arm. Mrs. Voorhees was ready. She was coming. "Oh my God!" Alice looked left, the broken paddle. Right, the machete. The long, narrow blade was almost dazzling in the moonlight. A vicious slash across the sand that sent a message that needed no voice. "Use me." Alice bent down, seized the machete in both hands, and went rushing forward, in denial of every civilized code she'd ever learned or lived by. She broke through all moral restraints and ran screaming toward Pamela Voorhees, with only one outcome in her mind. Pamela, for so long the hunter, was now facing an impossible truth. Her mouth sagged in horror, her eyes opened wide. This could not be. She was the predator, not the prey. She was the one who dealt the red hand of death. She would decide when. Alice snarled, lashed out with the machete, and lopped the head of Mrs. Voorhees clean off its shoulders. Over and over it turned, a ball of severed arteries pitching with ragged lines of skin, until frozen in an expression of fear, finally hitting the sand in a puddle of blood slush. Pamela's hands clutched at the air, driven by willpower but ultimately defeated by the spurting stump of her neck. Slowly, like the falling of rotted timber, her headless corpse dropped to its knees and then pitched forward, spewing chips of broken spine into the dirt. Pamela Voorhees was dead. The voice in her mind, the voice of an 11-year-old Jason calling to her from 1957, "Kill her, Mommy! Kill them all!" had been silenced. But at that moment, in the light of the full moon, something that no one ever could have expected took place. There was a shifting in the darkness. Not the dark of the night, but the darkness of the soul. When Alice shuddered, she thought it was with the release of someone who had stared into the gouged eyes of hell and had somehow pulled through. She had no way of knowing she had just unleashed a monstrous evil. But 2 months later, that same evil would come back to destroy her. 2 months from now, Alice Hardy would be dead. For this was an evil that would never die. Here at Camp Crystal Lake, Camp Blood, Alice had unwittingly set in motion a spear gun of bloody slaughter that would shoot its way through hundreds of victims over an unimaginable number of years. Because tonight, beneath the bloated moon, Mrs. Voorhees would learn that her boy hadn't drowned at all. Yes, he had fallen into the water. Yes, he had nearly died. But he'd survived. Damaged, frightened, confused. The retarded boy had crawled out of the lake and spent his whole life scavenging in the woods. But now that Pamela Voorhees was dead, she discovered something that would make things much better for her poor, sweet boy. Mommy had found a very special gift for her son. Something that would change his life forever. And this was the perfect day to give it to him, because the date of Pamela's death was Friday the 13th of June, 1980. Jason's birthday. Okay, folks, this has been the prologue of Friday the 13th, Carnival of Maniacs. And if that prologue don't get you pumped for the rest of this book, I don't know what else I can say. Anyways, guys, I'm glad to be back, starting on our 15th book for the channel. Hope you guys have been enjoying all the books I've been putting out so far. In the Black Flame series of Jason books, this is the final one. But we still have the Eric Morse series that we're going to do of Jason books. There's five of those. And also we have the novelizations of Part 3 and Part 6 that I'll be doing. And the Freddy vs. Jason novelization. We got so many more Freddy, Jason, and Michael books to come. It's crazy. Anyways, guys, I'll see you very soon with Chapter 1 and 2 of Friday the 13th, Carnival of Maniacs. Let me know in the comment section what you thought of the prologue and if you're excited to hear the rest. Until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and...
kill her, Mommy! Kill her! Kill them all!